to welcome the participants in this last panel, and I will say a few words on our participants, but let me start with a statement of what we are now trying to do. This is basically the final session. We have a long day. We looked at different aspects of these new standards that the ISSB has been proposing. And I think one of the lessons, at least that I take, is the longer we discuss, the more we get down to the issue of data, of standardization, that this is relevant, may have effects for many participants, maybe for the investor, maybe for the consumer, maybe for the firm. We heard this. But in the end, the word standardization has this connotation that this is that there is one standard, right? That there is one thing where everybody coordinates on and can look at. And I think in this last panel, we want to address the issue: what is the reality of standardization nowadays? And this is not that there is one standard where the world has agreed upon, but there are maybe two at minimum. Two we have on the table, maybe two and a half if taxonomy is seen as a standard, or three in that case. And there are actually many more out there, but I think these are the most important ones that are currently being discussed here in Europe. And the issue that we want to address in this final round has been mentioned, or has been named: how do sustainability standard setters compete, coordinate, or collaborate? So, what is their relationship at present and going forward? So, it's more like a question than a big issue for profound research, but it's a policy issue actually, and I'm glad to welcome our participants. I want to introduce them quickly in the order of the alphabet. So I think the alphabet is the most innocent way of ordering things. So we start with Patrick de Cambourg. He is the president of the Autorité des Normes Comptable in France, and also the chair of the EFRAG project task force, so which is the one group, and probably Patrick will say a few words on what exactly they are doing. Patrick has a long life as an expert in this field of auditing, but also an entrepreneur. So if I didn't misunderstand, you have developed a very small company into a global enterprise that does consulting and auditing services, and so that's really standard setters in the end will have to face the auditor who might check whether something is real. And so I think this background is definitely here at the table, and also the whole EFRAG initiative and strategy will probably be here at the table, and we will hear a bit of that in the beginning. I want to welcome Sven Gentner, who is next in line. He is the head of unit for asset management in the European Commission's Directorate General FISMA, so basically the group in the European Commission that thinks about financial markets and also oversight over financial markets and the regulatory efforts there. It's on the law-making side or law-proposing side. And Sven Gentner has a long history with the European Commission and has also been involved in this standard development over many years. Sven Gentner is also coming off with one leg of his education here from Goethe University, so I'm particularly happy to have him here today. Third in line is Sue Lloyd. We have talked or heard your talk already in the morning, so I don't need to say a lot. She's the ISSB vice chair and also very much concerned with the technical side of the standard setting process, so I think the exact right person to discuss this issue of how to unify standard setting over the longer haul. And last person in this row, Martin Maloney. I'm very glad that you have agreed to come. He is the Secretary General of IOSCO, which is the global representation of the supervisors of markets, of market supervisors. So this is the supervisory view, and now we are a view all these issues that relate to capital market information. And I hope there is a condensed view from your side on that issue of finding standards. So we have spoken a bit before this meeting, and we have agreed that there is a starting statement by everybody on the panel, like an elevator pitch on their, let's say, method, their methodology, their system that they are representing. And I think we just go in the same order. So maybe, Patrick, you would start and saying a few words on the EFRAG approach. We have now talked a lot about the ISSB approach today. So maybe EFRAG is the same as ISSB. You also have a consultation process ongoing. So maybe you can, maybe it's not the same, so I didn't want to say that it's the same, but maybe you can describe quickly what is the essence of the EFRAG approach to the standard setting, and then maybe if you find particular differences that are worth mentioning in the beginning, then maybe you can do this. We should do this in a short piece of intervention so that we have time for discussion. Patrick, please.
Thank you very much. In effect, Sven should have started because, you know, EFRAG is operating under a mandate received following the legislative, the directive that has been just approved, and Sven will probably give you the highlights on that. So under the CSRD, Corporate Sustainability Reporting Directive, EFRAG has been established as the quote-unquote standard setter, but I have to be careful here because we are elaborating the standards as technical advice to the Commission under the legal system in the EU, and the Commission will adopt them as delegated acts following its own process. EFRAG was the organization in the EU advising the Commission on the endorsement of IFRS for implementation in the EU. And in the last 3-4 years, on the basis, maybe 5 years, on the basis of the emergence of sustainability reporting, it developed an activity which has been recognized by the Commission and which now creates the role. So basically what has been done is very simple. We conducted preparatory work with a task force, starting in September 2020 until March 2021. So the report is available on the website. Recommendations to the Commission on how to draft standards in the EU, which is very compatible with what is in the Corporate Sustainability Reporting Directive, which was tabled in April 2021. Then Commissioner McGuinness told us, look, guys, we have a tight time frame, so could you start elaborating standards in project mode? So we started with the same task force in June 2021, so a little more than a year ago, drafting the standards that are required by the directive. And we worked pretty hard. On the basis of a due process, on the basis of a multi-stakeholder organization, we had 35 experts from 13 member states representing all the various origins of, you know, stakeholder. And we produced, at the end of April, 13 exposure drafts, which, as you mentioned, have been put forward for consultation. At the same time, the governance of EFRAG has been modified to establish a sustainability reporting board and a technical expert group, which is the second pillar. We have a similar organization for the financial reporting that has been populated on the basis of an extended membership involving NGOs, trade unions, civil society users, preparers, of course, and auditors as well. And this board now has taken over from the task force, which has been wrapped up, if I may say so. And now we are contemplating, you know, the finalization of those standards. It's going to be heavy work in the coming month. because the Commission is asking us to deliver a first set of standards in November this year for implementation in publication in 2025 on reporting year 2024 for large companies under the EU definition. 13 standards appears to be a lot because the CSRD is expecting a coverage of environmental topics, social topics, and governance topics. So it's really an ESG reporting. It will be in the shape and form of what we call sustainability statements. So we have the financial statements and we expect to have the sustainability statements as a separate section of the management report, clearly identified, because this is standardized, the standardized element of, you know, of sustainability matters. And well, I don't want to be too long, but I can elaborate further in the rest of the
maybe you can say one sentence on climate risk. So one, just taking out
so
one
it's
of
it
these.
It is no, one.
We have discussed a lot on this, and that's probably the most concrete
yes,
one.
Yes, we recognize the urgency and the importance of climate. So in fact, if I give a brief description of the architecture of standards, we have two cross-cutting standards. One, which is establishing the principles to be followed, which is somehow the counterpart to the can be compared and we try to make it compatible with the provisions of S1, which Sue presented this morning, I understand. The other cross-cutting standards is covering the topics that are for all topics, the disclosures that are covering all topics like strategy, governance, risk, and impact management. I should mention that we are requested to prepare standards under what is called the double materiality approach, which includes impacts and risks, which has been discussed. So two cross-cutting standards, five on environment, one being climate change, the other one being biodiversity, water, pollution, and circular economy. On the social side, four standards, one dedicated to the own workforce, workers in the value chain, affected communities, customers and end users, and governance, general governance, and also business conduct, corruption, anti-bribery, etc.
Okay, well, let's leave it at that for the moment. And Sven, maybe you could basically pull back a second and say the European approach that comes from the Commission on this issue.
Sure. But first to say that I'm really very happy to be here and also be back at the university where I studied in the 1990s. And it looks a lot nicer than it did at the time. even though I have to say the food in the canteen is still similar, and that's reassuring when I had lunch there today. But maybe it was my fault what I chose. Anyway, no, it's very nice to be here, and I'm glad to be invited to this event. Patrick has explained everything, I think, around the standards and how they're being developed in the European Union. But I think the key issue here is that the Union, the EU, and that means the European legislature at the initiative of the Commission, but in the end it's the Parliament and the Council who decide, has decided to put a legal framework in place that will oblige companies to disclose this information on sustainability, on the whole range of ESG factors. Why has the legislator chosen to do so? Because we don't only have a framework in place for corporates, we already have a framework in place for financial markets where we require asset managers, for example, to disclose this kind of information, where we require institutional investors, pension funds to disclose this kind of information, and they, of course, in turn, need the information from the corporates to be able to fulfill these requirements. On top of that, we also have legal requirements in the European Union where we've committed ourselves to reduce, for example, greenhouse gas emissions by 2030 by 55% and move to climate neutrality by 2050. So we're operating in a legal framework through which we try to achieve certain very, very concrete policy targets which we think are important to achieve, and I don't need to explain why. It's been discussed at length during the day, I think. So important here is we think we need a legal framework that will ensure that investors, stakeholders, financial market participants get the information from the corporates, get reliable information, get comparable information, and get all the information that they need to take the right decisions, and the right decisions hopefully will move us away from doing business in an unsustainable way. So as Patrick has explained already, we've now got this legal framework, which was agreed only 3 weeks ago on the 21st of June between Parliament and Council, which is the Corporate Sustainability Reporting Directive. This Corporate Sustainability Reporting Directive, as a piece of European law, defines which companies fall under it, which areas need to be covered, all six environmental topics already defined by the taxonomy, social, governance. It defines as of when it will apply, first the big companies, then the smaller ones, then the smallest. It will also introduce an assurance requirement, which will say that auditors need to look at this kind of information, need to verify it. It defines what the standards need to do in terms of how they interact with other pieces of European law, emissions trading scheme, Green Deal, Fit for 55, and so on. And finally, it also defines how we should operate or interoperate with the international standard setters, because of course we have an interest that the standards that we produce are interoperable with the standards that are being developed by the ISSB, as long as we also manage to fulfill all the legal requirements that we've set ourselves in the European Union, because as I said, they're tied to other kinds of legal requirements in terms of greening our economy. So there's a balance to be struck, but already moving ahead to the next topic, I guess, there's a lot of exchange going on, and I think we'll get to a good result.
Okay, so I just thank you. I head over to
panel finished.
Yes, Sue Lloyd on basically also exactly commenting on this. Maybe interoperability is the key word to address the question whether you. I mean, I'm not really clear what interoperability in that context means. I mean, can we have several standards that we can just exchange for each other? Or maybe you can say a few words on how you see the process from the ISSB side in terms of getting to a global standard. That's what in the end we need.
Yeah, so that's a good question, and your question's an interesting one. I hope that it's coordination and collaboration rather than competition. World's got enough problems without us competing with each other. But yes, I think if I can take us back to the presentation that I gave this morning and the sort of vision of the board as a starting point, because I think it's a good example of the sort of idea that we were trying to work with. So if you can remember back to this morning, I was talking about the fact that the ISSB is establishing this global baseline designed to be used around the world and to be ideally fit for purpose to meet the needs of investors making decisions about their investments, taking into consideration sustainability risks and opportunities. And we're really working hard with our stakeholders around the world to make sure that that's truly fit for purpose globally. Small companies, larger companies, and different types of economies. And as I said this morning, this global baseline is really important to us because global capital markets are global, and investors need to be confident they can make accurate and valid comparisons between companies in different parts of the world. So that's our dream. But then, of course, this morning I also acknowledged the fact that other people have got other legitimate objectives, and so the objective which Europe has, which they should be complimented for, and I should say congratulations on the CSRD, by the way, because that's a big piece of work, so well done. It gives Europe a very particular mandate that Patrick and Sven have just been talking about, this double materiality focus to meet public policy needs in Europe. And it's a really good example of what I was talking about this morning, that we're interested in global comparability. We're focused on meeting the needs of investors in a way that facilitates good international decision making. But there are then going to be situations when jurisdictions have got their own particular information needs, including when they've got to meet the needs of others beyond just investors, where we need to find a way to get from our investor-focused global baseline to those jurisdictional specific needs. And that's where our idea of the building blocks approach comes in, which is trying to make sure that we have a base of common information that meets investor needs, but with additional disclosures that meet then the public policy needs, so that two can coexist. And the dream, I think, and there's different ways that maybe interoperability can pan out, but I think that the desire, certainly from our side, is if we could find a situation where companies could be comfortable that they could meet my disclosure requirements under the ISSB requirements and communicate well with investors, and in so doing, achieve much of what is required from a European perspective in terms of what they're required to do to meet the European requirements and to meet a portion of the information needs for Europe, and then in addition providing additional disclosures to meet the double materiality aspect, that would be in a very efficient and effective system. We'd have the global comparability around the world, but we would also be true to the fact that we know that Europe rightly has got a particular legislative mandate that they need to fulfill. Mm-hmm. But that's sort of how we're thinking about this interoperability idea.
Yeah, let me just to a matter of basic understanding these terms. I have heard very often interoperability, baseline and so forth, but it's not so really clear what's the underlying information that's coming out. So in my, let's say, naive mind, I would say there is a data dimension for the whole issue of setting sustainability standards. That is defining a metric. Let's say we talk about climate risk or let's say carbon emissions could be then the variable. You select the variable, you define a metric on this. So how do I exactly measure and attribute at the corporate level? So that would be part one, so to speak. And that should be identical across countries, basically. If that is what you mean with baseline. Well, and then there's other things that can be attached. For instance, the rules that are applicable with respect to this standards, this metric. Do I have to reduce it within 10 years, within 20 years, not at all? That's national. That's sovereign, so to speak. But the metric is the same everywhere. And that's a bit how I'm, maybe that's too naive a picture, but how I could imagine that we have this baseline versus the build-up, so to speak. Well, but maybe we ask Martin first to give his view of how such a global perspective could be imposed on this discussion.
So yes, I'm very glad to and very happy to be here to talk about this, because it's really a burning topic at the moment, and I do really like the way you think about it, because in terms of my answer, and I don't think I'd use the word interoperability, but it's a useful term to at least put a question mark beside to figure out what it means. My answer would be similar to yours in the sense that I would start from the question of data. Now let me try, I wonder could I take a step back just to explain that. Maybe not talk about sustainability at all for a couple of minutes, talk about standards. Because the question of global standards and how they work in relation to capital markets is an interesting question in itself, which is actually very relevant to this discussion. So if you look at what my organization does, we basically curate a set of standards for global capital markets. Now, how did we get to that position? In a naive view, you might say, well, presumably they just dictated a set of standards and everybody then said yes and complied. Of course, that's not what happened at all. But by the same token, the opposite didn't happen either, that we just waited for good practices to emerge and then we just described them and we didn't have any sort of leading role at all. What's actually happened over the course of the last 30 years is that we have waited until standards emerged or good practices emerged, and then as they have emerged, we have codified them, and then jurisdictions which were, if you like, late to the process have accepted that codification. So it's part following, part leading, part orchestrating, part directing. It's quite a complex process by which capital markets standards have developed. And they don't, strictly speaking, have compulsion in relation to jurisdictions. And it's important to say that jurisdictions have a lot of discretion. So what do jurisdictions do when we then develop a global standard in relation to something, or through an organization like the IFRS, ask them to do it and sort of check to make sure their processes are in the public interest? Jurisdictions can do a number of things which are very helpful. One of the things they can do is say, that's great, we're putting it into our regulation. So that's the easy one, that's sort of the top-down approach. What they can also do sometimes, though, is just do nothing. And if there are no obstacles in their jurisdiction to the standard being rolled out in their jurisdiction. And this does happen quite a lot in capital markets. They can just do nothing and the industry will adopt the standard within their jurisdiction because it's being adopted elsewhere. That doesn't work if there's a significant obstacle in their jurisdiction to the standard being adopted. If they do nothing and there's a significant obstacle domestically, then you clearly don't get conformity from that jurisdiction. So funnily enough, you can get a jurisdiction doing the same thing with opposite impacts, depending on the context. And then sometimes they can do something quite small, which is they can just, let's say it's a data standard or something like that, they can change a regulatory reporting format to apply that data standard, and suddenly all the firms in that jurisdiction want to use it because it's now become easy and supportive for them. So the question for us, I think, which is going to arise when we reach the point next year that we endorse, as I think there's now an increasingly strong likelihood that we will, although there's a few steps left to go, endorse the ISSB standard, is we will be asking jurisdictions, what are they going to do to actually promote, implement, support this standard? And for me, the bottom line, coming back to your point, is if you do something to support and promote this standard, which helps to create a global data management industry that is all working off the same data points, where there are global economies of scale for the participation in that industry, then you have done something positive. Mm-hmm. If you are doing the opposite and you are, let's say, seeing the ISSB data set over here and you are operating off a different data set, then you are promoting global fragmentation. Mm-hmm. And you are preventing the development of a globally integrated data management system, keeping in mind that the asset management sector outsources almost all its data management requirements to somebody else. Yeah. So it's a specialist sector that has to develop to really deal with sustainability information.
So this global reach or the global, let's say, uniformity at some level, while accepting that there are differences on a, for each market depending on their way of regulating things. So where is this line exactly? I'm looking to Sven for that. Is that a concept that you would buy into to say there is this what earlier was called the global baseline, which I understand as that feature which is common to all the standards that may exist in different countries that could be used by markets as the basis for their valuation, and the rest is, so to speak, add-on that's nation-specific. Is that a concept that is reflected in your approach?
No, I think it is reflected in the sense that even our law says that we should try to ensure that we avoid undue burden by creating standards that are not interoperable. But as I said, at the same time, we need to also respect different objectives. So I think the difficulty we're in at the moment is, the biggest difficulty is, we're under enormous time pressure, and the time pressure comes not from regulators being fast or late or whatever. The time pressure comes because we're faced with a big problem in the real world, and the big problem is climate change and all that. And basically that's where the time pressure comes, and it's broken down in all the different sectors. So we're doing everything at a very high pace, and we have to do it in parallel, because neither can we wait for the ISSB to create a set and then base ourselves on that, nor can the ISSB wait for jurisdictions to do something and then bring it together and think it through and redo it. There's no time for it. By the time the world will be, I don't know at what degrees. So we're under a lot of time pressure. We need to work in parallel. We have different approaches policy-wise, because as Sue explained, the ISSB has a certain view of the world in terms of investor focus. We go much further. We look at stakeholders. We look at other policy objectives. So somehow we need to bring all this together and still ensure that companies are not saddled with burdens and reporting on different kind of sets of standards that are not compatible, and where they have to do things twice, or where they're reported here in one way and there in another way. That's not straightforward, and the devil is in the detail. And it's not just one metric, if I may, because of course, even when it comes to greenhouse gas emissions, you're talking about strategies, you're talking about different types of greenhouse gas emissions, you're talking about offsetting, about compensating, about different ways how you can deal with them, kind of goals that you can set yourselves. And that's the kind of stuff where we're trying to work through at the moment and find ways how to make sure that our policy objectives are met, because in a sense that's the driving force, but nevertheless that we can ensure that companies will not have to report different types of sets of standards, which
the situation, we decompose the standard setting approaches into the investor view and other views, let's say, would that be an approach that is feasible? Maybe I asked that Patrick and Sue, because it affects their approaches. So my ultimate question is there alignment? So and if so, how could that happen? And one naive thinking from my side would be, you have these two parts. You have the investor or capital market side, which is probably the same in all, no matter how you look at it. And then there is all the other additional aspects that you may bring in.
Well, if I may, Sven said it, the devil is sometimes in the details. So, you know, I think the key point is that we need to have a regular dialogue in the initiative, because, you know, sustainability reporting is an emerging discipline. So, you know, we are all working hard. We are here in a university. I think that I would sincerely recommend additional research on many topics at academic level. When we conduct, analysis, we are looking at what is done by academics. Sometimes we miss the conceptual thinking or the empirical, of course, by definition, the empirical studies. So dialogue is at the heart of interoperability and compatibility, you call it the way you want. What we want to avoid is multiple reportings. I am wondering if, you know, enterprise value as described as the objective of the ISSB and double materiality, the way we describe it under the EU CSRD, are at the end of the day so different. I'm not sure. Because, you know, you never know. We feel that we have to start with the analysis of impacts of the entity on environment and people, because that is the key element of relationship between the entity, the undertaking, and the ecosystem in which it operates. Now, that being said, we recognize that some impacts may not have a financial consequence today, and it is very difficult to know when, even on the basis of a reputational risk, when does it become financially material? When is it going to affect cash flows in a positive or negative manner? So I think we need to drill down further. And by the way, I don't know how many meetings we had, Sue, between the TRWG and now the ISSB and IFRAG, probably more than 10 or 12. So there is an ongoing dialogue, and I think it's absolutely key. What is important, sorry to mention this, is of course, due to the urgency and the political decisions made in the EU, we have a time constraint, and we have also a coverage that is quote unquote imposed to the standard setter. So we cannot wait on this one.
So how would be your view on this?
Well, I think there's two things that I think that we're trying to keep in mind, certainly from our side, and I think it's in common with my friends in Europe. One is thinking about the information that's provided sort of as the output, and the other is thinking about the experience for the company being asked to prepare the information, because it's two sort of ends of the same exercise, if you like. And I think we want to do as much as we can to make it as straightforward as possible for the company doing the reporting, that they can go through the most simple exercise possible and aren't being asked to do two totally separate sets of analysis, if at all possible. And that at the end, that we have a situation where investors truly can make these global comparisons that we would like them to make with the information that's been identified as being, you know, the important information for investors to make their investment decisions, and that the information, that the additional impact information that Europe needs is also available. And we need to find a mechanism to do that as efficiently as possible. I think if we were, you know, both to be starting now, which we're not, if we were both to be starting now with a clean sheet of paper, the neatest and tidiest way, I think, to do that is with the building block approach, where you'd start with the same words to do the sort of enterprise value exercise, and then you'd come along with additional information that provides, you know, the additional pieces that tie in with the CSRD and the impact perspective. But we have timing issues, and we've got different drafts at the moment, and so we're doing everything we can to get as close as we possibly can to that nirvana within the constraints that we have. I think what's really, really important for the ISSB is that at the end of the day, investors can get this common global picture, whether it's coming from a European company or a Chinese company or an Australian company. That's this common set of comparable information. That's, you know, the goal that I'm going to be looking for. And for us, it's really important that that information is transparent and that it's not obscured by other information that really isn't so important for investors, even when it is legitimately important for other purposes. Mm. And that's the challenge that we're trying to balance at the moment. And I think we're working cooperatively to try to achieve that.
Okay, so, but this I mean, leads to the follow-up question. So, how is this process really actually been led to a result? You said in next year you want to basically make a decision about the standard that you want to recommend. So, but by then, this should have been concluded, right? There should have been this baseline approach. If it's acceptable to everybody on the table, it should be there right by then.
I think the point that's made about speed and how speed affects how we're all engaging with this is really important. So, because for just to take an example of our relationship to the ISSB, in an ideal world, we would be doing nothing in relation to what the ISSB are currently working on until they were finished, and then we would begin. But what we're actually doing is we're doing our process in parallel with them in order to try to speed the process up. It's the same with the relationship between Patrick and Sven and the European Union and the ISSB. They're also working in parallel. So you can have a conversation at this moment in time which is ridden with uncertainty and phrases that don't necessarily seem compatible because everybody's trying to do things in parallel and get to an outcome. It may seem slightly sentimental, but I come back to the point that there's actually goodwill on all sides to end up with an aligned process. And I also come back to your point, which is you will know that it has failed if you have not got a core set of data points whereby you can compare companies across the globe in order to assess their position. Because the European Union, like other jurisdictions and regions, has requirements in relation to its public policy. Mm-hmm. But they will also want, as I suspect everybody else wants, to be able to see analysts looking at a European country and an American company and a Hong Kong listed company and comparing them in relation to the key metrics that we're talking about. And that can't happen if those key metrics are not being produced out of each jurisdiction and areas mm-hmm. process. So that is the criterion of success.
Okay, so can we expect this list of criteria that will come from Josko?
No, I think the way that will work.
I mean,
I think the way that will work mm-hmm. is that we will look at what the ISSB has produced. We will satisfy ourselves as whether that works for financial markets. We have published or publishing a set of 20 criteria that we will apply in order to establish that. And when we have done that, we will then push jurisdictions, or encourage jurisdictions, to make a decision as to what they are going to do next in relation to that. Mm-hmm. And I think there will be an almost automatic process of public accountability for jurisdictions and regions where people who are really interested in and motivated in relation to what's happening in this sector, who will be asking them, what have you done? Where have you got to?
Yeah.
And where we will certainly be continuing to engage with jurisdictions to help them if they're having problems getting to a good place. But without a preset approach on our part that you have to do it this way or that way, and with an absolute principle that the more you want to do in terms of also creating information for public policy debate, nothing we're doing and nothing the ISSB is doing should get in the way of that to the slightest degree.
Sorry.
I mean, I fully agree with what has been said, but maybe just to add to that, and that's another complication. I mean, as Patrick and I have described in the European Union, the set of standards that we're going to adopt, that EFRAG is going to send to us end of this year, and that we're going to adopt next year, already covers not just climate, but also covers biodiversity, land use, water, pollution, social elements, governance. The ISSB, I think, is thinking about moving into other areas. They will, if I understand correctly, also consult on the future agenda and all that. So we have a difference also in terms of the scope, in a sense, of what we're talking about at the moment. And I think in that sense, coming back to your question, what is the process? I think it's a process that will take quite some time, because it will take us a long time to put all of this in place within Europe, at the international level. And we need to keep in mind that I think it's very likely, given changes in science, more insight into climate change and different policy objectives, that we'll also see continuous changes in that sense. I mean, in 5 years' time, I'm pretty sure that we will want to see other types of information, we'll have other types of goals to achieve, and that will have to be reflected again in the standards, because, as I said, they're not as simple as saying, okay, disclose your CO2 emissions. No, it goes much further than that. So I think also that adjustment has to take place. So it will be a continuous process within jurisdictions and between jurisdictions.
Yeah. And if I, sorry.
Yeah, Patrick and Sue.
No, I just, you know, we highlight some of the hurdles, but I would like also to say that so far, I mean, based on the dialogue and also on the careful analysis of what has been produced by other initiatives, because we are mentioning the ISSB, but we could mention also the Global Reporting Initiative, which is, of course, a well-recognized, impact-oriented standard setter. But from what I see, we wouldn't be too far in terms of, you know, having a common basis. If I take climate, for instance, ISSB and EFRAG are inspired by TCFD. Anyway, so you know, is there a big difference? Okay, maybe more granular, a little more this or that, more sectorial here. But I mean, at this stage, I would assess that, in terms of general principle, general orientations, and on the topic that has been addressed by the ISSB, we are pretty close.
Mm-hmm. So would you say the same?
I'd love to be agreeable, but I need to be careful. I think where we do have commonalities is that within the proposed disclosures in the European exposure drafts, there is a lot of commonality in disclosures that are required. So much of what we are proposing would be required for example on climate is encompassed in Europe's exposure draft, so I would agree with that. However, we've got some key differences and some of them are quite structural. So for example, we have four pillars taken from TCFD and there's a slightly different approach in Europe. But also I think the key difference between our approach and Europe's approach is that it's what's one of the key concepts that we have in our general requirements document is that because of the building block approach, we've acknowledged that additional information can be provided in the sustainability information over and above what has been identified by the ISSB as being the material information for investors, but only as long as it's not obscured by other information. And I think the biggest structural challenge we have at the moment, and it's one that we're trying to brainstorm ways to address, so we shouldn't all, you know, get overly concerned, but it is a difference which is important, is that at the moment the particular globally comparable investor information that we're shooting for actually wouldn't be visible because it's within the context of a lot of other information which is there for impact.
It's not two parts.
Yeah, it's not two parts. Yeah. And that, I think, is the thing that we're trying to put energy into.
But that could be a direction.
It could be a direction of travel, but it is non-trivial to do, and we're spending lots of time together trying to look at it at the moment.
So I have a little problem because our time is more over and Sven has to jump to the airport, to the train station, even worse.
Sustainable.
But there are so many more people who would like to say.
Train.
What I would suggest is that those who want to make one sentence statement in the group should do this, and then we try to summarize. So, Anna, you wanted to say something, please, but short and crisp.
So I'm in an ideal world, aircraft would only be building on the ISSB's basic standards and add the information for other stakeholders, right? What about a situation if the ISSB already requires, let's say, scope 3 emissions, and the EU is so wise to say, okay, scope 3 wouldn't be mandatory until 10 years from now, until we have, well, better data on it? What happens then?
We take this question in our heads. Tobias, you want to say something? No. Okay. Anybody else? Who? Yeah.
Katrin. One issue I think is really challenging is now the time pressure. And we have been watching, obviously, the aircraft process and biodiversity researchers. So we have looked at the standard that have, or disclosure standard that has been put out. And what we don't want to have is now path dependency that we cannot change in the future. With all the new information coming out, especially in biodiversity, we're just starting to get all the data together. Is there a way to, and that it seems crucial, to have the data on biodiversity ecosystems and the tools as public knowledge and something that can be scrutinized by science, so that we're allowed to look into the process and to keep up to date on basic newest developments in science be constantly in the position to improve the situation.
Yeah, I think this is a demand from the academic side for all aspects that you want to standardize, that there is a basic level of data which is credible, reliable, integer, measurable and disclosed and accessible by everybody, and then the rest is regulation. Right? You can put on top everybody how he likes to do it, but the fact part is, which is important for us as researchers, and I think we can also contribute to the whole process, but we need this step. And maybe we have a one last, yeah, okay, yeah, please, one last question.
Not the scientific aspects on the present of the German accounting standards.
Yeah, Herr Lehmann.
Thank you. And we had been at simply like a last plea in order simply like to get perhaps near to results. And I think what we discussed also is the time pressure. November we heard as a date in the end to deliver the standards. I think in the meantime also some action has been brought forward. And we talk about climate in the first instance in the end. How can we bring things together? And we should use that time until November. And this would be at least my idea also for a future in the end, because we at the moment, I think tomorrow will be the hearing in the European Parliament on the question who should be the future in the end sustainability reporting board chairman of AFRAG, that this personality would also bring this topic particularly forward in order simply like to make this thing work. Because I think this is why we are sitting here. This has been the conviction, I think also if you look at simply like what has been the drivers also for Germany in bringing this thing here to Frankfurt is certainly finally a globally consistent reporting framework. This is what we are all striving for, and we should use that time, I think, what we have also until November to make that happen.
Very well said words, I think. So everybody one sentence to conclude. There's unfortunately no more time for that, but Patrick, you want to start? Can we reach the alignment?
No, I tried to give a sign of optimism.
Yeah.
You know, substance first, structure maybe. We can see where, you know, structure might be an issue when you are in paper reading. In digital reading, you probably are less, under the influence of the structure. I certainly see a big future in creating. A commonality, but there is a lot. I'm more worried by other areas than the EU to be interoperable with the ISSB, because I would like to see, for instance, the evolution in the US with the SEC proposal in the current. Political environment, etc. So, we have to gain traction, and it's certainly by, having an excellent relationship between the ISSB and the EU that we can get the traction that we want at worldwide level to serve also the global businesses and also the local ones, by the way.
Sven, you want to say something?
I'm very optimistic that we'll find good and practical solutions to making the standards work together. I'm less optimistic in the sense whether this will be enough as for the standards themselves to achieve the real world objectives that we want to do. Okay. Means, I mean, will this be enough to stop the kind of developments that see out there? So if you look at the weather forecast, I'm less optimistic that when we look at the kind of cooperation that we're putting in place.
Yeah. So.
Well, we're all going to work hard. I think we've got a common commitment to try and get it to work, so definitely an intention of coordination and collaboration, so I think that's the good news. And to your question, this is where it gets tricky, where you've got different people with different objectives calling decisions, but our model is to try to agree what we think is necessary for global comparability. So if that were, for argument's sake, to include scope three, then we'd want it to be in
still
there.
Okay.
But it's making it globally acceptable, whatever that basis is.
Martin, last word.
I think we're at a really interesting moment. We're trying to do something really unusual, which is to move from voluntary standard setting to public interest global standards in relation to a huge public policy issue. This has never been done before. It's really interesting to see that even at this stage, despite the difficulties, it's actually possible to see the path to success. And that's fascinating that we actually could achieve this particular result. If we do achieve it, it's only one step along a pathway. The next step is in relation to auditing and assurance of that information, because it's one thing to get it into an accounting format that you can actually publish it. It's then a separate, almost equally challenging task to get assurance in relation to it. And that gets us to a point around 2025 where we start to have information that people can trust about corporate issuers. And then that really puts the whole question, the whole political question, back on the agenda in a whole new way, irrespective of who the information was designed for.
Thank you. I think this is a good concluding statement. We want to do this type of event in a more regular way, because we think this is a dynamic process in many dimensions. And we will revisit your optimistic statements in a short while. So thank you very much for your time and for your presence.